Thank you and good afternoon, everybody. In the next few minutes, I'll be speaking on the complications of scleral buckling, how prevention and management. These are my financial disclosures. So when we're talking of buckling, I think these are basically the headings under which we'll be discussing, from exposure, localization, cryo, scleral suture placements, drainage, scleral buckling, paracentesis, intravitreal injections, and closure. So exposure and localization. This scleral rupture or perforation while you are opening up the case in the conjunctiva is a rare in primary surgery. It used to be a bugbear with revision buckles when you are doing second and third revisions of buckles, but nowadays these are really, really rare. Most of the times you do vitrectomy. Otherwise, rectus muscle rupture again is something which you have to be careful about. If there's very thin muscle or very elderly patient, avoid much traction on such muscles, and better still, you pass an intrascleral traction suture at that anterior part and use that to produce the rotation rather than pulling too much on the muscle or the muscle belly. Once the muscle is lost, it can be really tough to find it back again. Vortex vein damage is again something which you have to guard against when you're passing your muscle hooks, and incorrect localization in very bullous detachments. So here we see how this works, that you, it's been a bullous detachment, you actually tend to localize much more posteriorly than was the actual break. And to avoid that, you can do various things, try and judge the distance of the break from the ora serrata. If the tear is large, see if you can anteriorly localize the anterior edge and then see where the size of the break and where the posterior edge would be. Any break in the vicinity, if it's in a non-bullous area, or the drain and flatten the retina and then localize as is done in the DACE procedure. Again, for retinal detachments where you cannot really look, find a retinal break, I remember Dr. Nagpal always calls that an unholy retinal detachment. So search and all over again on the table with hypotony, use different lenses. Nowadays people are using even chandelier illumination with a microscope in some of these cases to try and see if they can find the break. Keep the Linkoff's rules in mind. If you still can't find the break, either you have to buckle the extent of the retinal detachment or convert to a vitrectomy. Doing cryotherapy, be careful not to retreat same areas and excessive treatment, as that can cause RPE cell dispersion and trigger PVR and macular pucker. In bullous detachments, don't wait for the reaction to reach the retina. That will be over-treatment. And now we often prefer to do laser in many of these cases after the settling the retina on the table or even post-op rather than trying to do too much cryo. And again, importantly, once the ice ball forms, let it thaw before withdrawing the cryo probe. Otherwise, you can cause hemorrhages or even scleral rupture in very thin retina. We always like to use microscopes because that's very helpful in safe passage of scleral sutures, passing posterior sutures, avoiding vortices, and even SRF drainage. In scleral suture placement, the two things can be either insufficient depth, where the buckle may get poorly indented or cut through an extrusion later on, or perforation, in which case, if it's in detached retina, you would cause an early drainage of SRF. It's not really a big issue. You can pass a fresh suture. If the eye is very soft, you may need to inject air or ringer. If it's an attached retina, it's a bigger problem. You'll probably have a retinal break or incarceration. So you have to pass a fresh suture for a wider buckle and only then remove the offending suture. Avoid vortex vein injury. And if the sclera is very thin and staphylomatous, you may have to convert to a vitrectomy. So this is how you would avoid a vortex vein there. Either you can go over it, or if the vortex vein is very loose and this thing, you could actually even go under it and to the other side. This is the way you would support if you have a perf with a wider buckle. And in a hypotonic eye, if you take a longer bite, it's sometimes difficult, it's tricky, so you may take two shorter bites for the buckle indentation. Again, a very staphylomatous sclera, so you would convert to a vitrectomy, would be much better in a case like that. SRF drainage is the most complication fraught step in buckling surgery. Hemorrhage can occur and can be totally unpredictable, so stick to drainage sites on either side of the recti if possible, and the watershed zones here. So if possible, we always tend to drain on the either side of the superior or inferior rectus. within the watershed area between the vortex vanes. And I like to use a mini flap because it gives a very controlled this thing. You get a thinner sclera there, make an incision there and drain it, and then you can close the mini flap at the end of. Here is just depicting that's an unpredictable subretinal bleed. If you get that, if there's raise the head end of the patient, turn the eyeball with the suture so that the blood is directed away from the macula. Preferably don't drain dry. The presence of SRF gives the blood a chance to migrate down away from the macula. Use gas if possible and position prone post-op to shift the heme away from the macula as you would do for a subretinal hemorrhage. And if there's a very large hemorrhage, then you may have to convert to vitrectomy and remove as you do for a submacular hemorrhage. If there's retinal incarceration, you suspect if there's sudden stoppage to the drainage of subretinal fluid, confirm from the indirect ophthalmoscopy, you support it with a buccal. A mini flap again is very helpful in this situation if it's outside the buccal area. And if the vitrectomy incarceration is very large, then it's better again, as we said in the case of sclerotomy, that it's better to convert to a vitrectomy in a situation like that. You have to assess the buccal after the tightening it to see that all the breaks are adequately covered, the anterior, posterior, and the lateral margins. Prone to error is the anterior. If you may have a posterior coverage, but if the anterior edge is not covered, you may have trickling down of the fluid and an inferior detachment coming on like this. So a good indentation is important, not over and not under. Very high buccal causes radial folds or fish mouthing and is best avoided by moderate height of the buccal and gas or air injection. Again, don't tie the band too high. Yeah, this is certainly very undesirable. This would be much more ideal. This would problem late complication like intrusion, anterior segment ischemia, cutting through of the band, a closed line phenomena as we saw with the supramid sutures. For the intravitreal injection, use a 29 or 30 gauge needle, inject a single bubble, visualize the tip of the needle in the vitreous cavity and not very deep in, inject steadily and don't push up the intraocular pressure too high. If the pressure is high, you need to do a paracentesis. We stabilize the globe with a traction suture and enter the AC with the tip of the 15 degree blade and depress the posterior lip of the stab incision. I prefer this method rather than putting a needle inside and actively withdrawing fluid. And you can repeatedly depress the lip and keep softening the eye as required. In earlier, nowadays these are rare, but in aphakic eyes where there could be vitreous towards the wound of the cataract, we like to do a 6 o'clock paracentesis that gave very good drainage through the paracentesis because otherwise the vitreous in the superior part would block the thing. For closure, adequate closure is very important to prevent buccal exposure and infection. We always do in two layers, the tenons and the conjunctiva. Thank you for your attention.